Hello, I'm Bob Harris, and 40 years ago this month, I was getting ready to host a very special live broadcast from the Hammersmith Odeon in London. The date was Christmas Eve, the band was Queen, and this old Grey Whistle Test concert was to be the climax of an incredible year for the band. They started 1975 on £20 a week, but they ended it with a classic album in A Night at the Opera and a chart-topping single in Bohemian Rhapsody. And over the next hour, we're going to find out how they did it through the memories of Roger Taylor and of Brian May.
It's getting a little dim now. We're talking how many years ago? 40 years ago, my God.
It's so hard when you try and cast your mind back into the 70s. It's like going back in a sort of brown, beige era when everybody smoked. And it almost feels like it was black and white, you know, but with beige and brown overtones.
In England that much at this time. You have to remember we were on tour most of the time. When we weren't on tour, we were in a studio, and you don't get out much when you're in the studio. I've got to tell you, you do not have a social life when you're in the studio. You may go out and drink after your session, but really you don't go any place and you don't see normal life. So from the point of view of experiencing what England was like, I couldn't tell you what England was like. I couldn't even tell you what kind of music was going on, because you're insulated from that as well, unless you make a big effort to get out. Because what was happening with us was so all-consuming. I would see my family, but I would basically, from about 1970 to somewhere in the 80s, we would tour 8 or 9 months of the year, and the rest of the time we'd be in the studio. So I can't tell you what England was like, really. I really can't. But I couldn't do anything about it. I just couldn't communicate. There was not a way of communicating with the world. I lost touch with all my friends from school, except my very, very closest friends. But those periods where it's full on and you're kind of conquering the world, that's it. That's what you do. And it was great. But, you know, it's a bit, people who go off to on ships to discover the Northwest Passage. It's the same thing, you know. They just dedicate their lives to that, and that's what they do. They come back a few years later, and everything's different. In a way, that's what I wrote. That's why I wrote 39, the wrong song. The wrong song at the right time. 39 was about a bunch of spacemen who went away on a journey. And to them, it was only a year. They hardly noticed the passage of time. But in their minds, but also in reality, because of the general relativistic time dilation effect, as discovered by Einstein, when they come back, it's 100 years later, and all their children have died. Their family, you know, their wives, their kids, probably their grandchildren have died, and they find everything is different. And that, you know, part of that was just kind of writing a jolly little folk song in the style of what folk music was when I was a kid. But also partly, I was kind of paralleling what our lives were like.
I'm Bob Harris, and this is 1975, the year of Queen. Back in those days, Freddie Mercury claimed to have never been on a bus in his life. But Brian May remembers the period rather differently.
Freddie's quoted as saying he would never go on a bus, but I went on a lot of buses with Fred. I got to tell you, in the days when we were signed to Trident Audio Productions, but nothing was happening, and David Bowie was appearing at Finsbury Park, or sort of the Rainbow, you know, and all kinds of people were having hits who we regarded as our generation, and nothing was happening with us. We would go up every day, me and Freddie, on the bus, the top at the front, and sit there, and I think it was the number 9, and we go up to Trident Audio Productions and sit in their offices and say, what is happening? Why haven't you done anything about management? Why don't we have any studio time? Because we had all the songs ready and everything. And basically, they were waiting until they had a little break in their schedules in their studio so they could shove us in dark time and not have to pay for it. So it was a bad situation, really. And yes, we saw buses. Me and Fred saw buses for sure. And having been through that for a long time, I mean, I went on the tube for years as well when I was teaching at a comprehensive school just prior to that. So I kind of paid my dues on public transport. But I don't want to go back to public. Given the choice, I don't want to go back.
Roger Taylor's song, I'm in Love with My Car, from A Night at the Opera. By the end of 1974, Queen looked to be on the up and up, but appearances were deceptive. Although, as Brian recalls, even hard times have their uses.
I think adversity does make you strong, and we had a fair bit of adversity. Me getting ill, you know, I got the hepatitis thing in the States, which was a real blow because we were just about to hit the West Coast, and obviously we never got there on the first tour. I got sick in Boston, woke up very yellow one morning, and I still don't really know why, but I had to be kind of smuggled home on the plane, and then Freddie had some problems too. We also had a very, very hard time with the press and the media in England. You know, we were very kind of vilified and dismissed.
We did feel like outsiders in a way, because we felt unfashionable. But that we were, had the strength of mind to realise that unfashionable wasn't necessarily a bad thing. Because I think if, you know, you could see people liking our music. I mean, a lot of people. And that made you think, well, who cares what you know, Nick, it doesn't matter, that's three people, you know, who are trying to make a name for themselves in acerbic journalism, and we're just trying to make music, really, and lots of people are liking it. We must be doing something right.
It bound us together as a group. I think when you feel, in a sense, attacked from the outside, it does make you strong. And the great thing about being a group as opposed to a solo artist is that you have that amazing resilience. You can work off each other, you can prop each other up when necessary, and each of us began to assume a role. It's like building the four corners of your castle, and we were... The great thing, we could say anything to each other, we could attack each other, and we did. So in a sense, nothing that anyone could say on the outside could be as bad as what we could wreak on each other. So we developed a very strong kind of fighting spirit, I think, yeah. And a belief, you know, we shared this belief that we were something special, you know, precocious boys, if you like. But if you don't have that belief, what is your driving force? Queen, we were a very well-oiled unit. You know, John was completely in rapport with Roger's bass drum. You know, you couldn't separate them. Amazing, the cohesion that was there. And of course, Freddie was Freddie, and would do anything, you know, what he felt like. And there were no boundaries for Freddie. If he felt like singing a particular thing at a particular time, he would just do it. So we would go with him.
Fred just wanted to shock people and or just make them laugh as well. You know, it's like a strange mixture of I mean, when we first saw him in his Kermit the Frog outfit, you know, with the Nijinsky ballet full length thing, we thought, Christ, you've got a nerve, and why not?
Freddie was a great player, yes, as well, a wonderful player, and sometimes underestimated, even by himself, I have to say, because later on he didn't want to play piano, he wanted other people to play it for him. But he had this wonderful percussive rhythmic touch,
yeah,
unequaled actually, and he could just drive the band effortlessly.
He was fantastic to play with.
He really was,
especially for a drummer, it's amazing rhythmic sense, actually. Yeah,
it was all very direct as well. There's only the four of us. There's no sort of safety net there at all. I mean, obviously there's no backing tapes. There's no extra musicians. Nothing. No. It's just four people on there. And I think that comes across. It does come across kind of dangerous and focused.
You had to be able to play well, otherwise you were. I mean, it was quite serious, you know. Virtuosos were the thing of the day in a way, you know. After Hendrix and Eric Clapton and all that stuff, and so you really had to be a good player, otherwise the student circuit would have laughed you off, really, you know. And I don't think, you know, you could just quirkiness wouldn't do it, you know.
I mean, going back to earlier times, and that there was a moment where there was the first time that anyone came to the show having heard the record. I mean, that's a big demarcation line as well. I remember playing some technical college in North London, and going along, nobody had heard of us. We were like Queen and Disco, and we played our first set, and then the Disco came on and did their thing. It was a college, I can't remember the name of the college, and people kind of danced around like they do, you know. Oh, what an interesting group. And then the lady who was the kind of head of Ents or whatever it was in the college came up and said, we've had a special request for the second half. And the people say, you know, they think you're very good, but could we have the Disco instead for the second half instead of you guys? So we went, do we get paid? I think, thanks, bye. So, I mean, that's the kind of stuff that happens to you. That's the kind of sort of confidence sapping thing that happens to everybody when they don't have a record out. People have no idea what they're looking at, and you know, they would say, you know, can you play Purple Haze, or you know, can you do Paranoid or whatever. You know, there's no concept that we were trying to say anything that was of any importance, and it's really only having a record out there which gives people the chance to absorb things and realize that this is something they might want to see.
She keeps them away, Chandon, in a pretty cabinet. Bethany Cake, she says, just like Marie Antoinette. A building remedy with Christoph and Kennedy. At a time of limitation, you can't decline. Caviar and cigarettes, well-versed in etiquette. Extraordinarily nice. She's a killer queen, gunpowder, gelatine. Dynamite with a laser beam. Guaranteed to blow your mind. She never kept the same address. In conversation, she spoke just like a baroness. Middleman from China, but down to Geisha might have been again, incidentally, me that way. Perfume came naturally from Paris. Naturally. Because she couldn't care less, fastidious and precise. She's a killer queen, gunpowder, gelatine. Dynamite with a laser beam. Guaranteed to blow your mind. Thank you. drop of a hat. Jesus, Milligan, playful as a pussycat. Momentarily out of action, temporarily out of gas. Absolutely dry. And appetite.
We've been to America and had some great beginnings of, you know, of success, and we really just wanted to be a rock band. No, it wasn't like we wanted to be a glam band, because the glam thing was sort of something a little bit over to one side. And yes, we did kind of have fingernail polish and a bit of makeup here and there, and we did go for the drama. It was always, but it was more like drama than let's be pretty. It was let's be dramatic in the music. We have lights, we have sound, we will wear the stuff which makes an impact, and we'll, you know, use what looks we have, I suppose. You know, the difference between us and, say, Slade on the one hand and, say, Kiss on the other hand is enormous. We're much closer, really, to groups who wanted to be loud and dangerous, I suppose. But, you know, it is hard to define what we were, and I don't think we ever really defined it ourselves. You know, Killer Queen, the song, doesn't fit into any of that. It's a very sophisticated and quite light record, and I remember having some doubts about it, because I thought, you know, perhaps it's gives the wrong idea about what we might be like on stage. But, you know, a good song is a good song, and a hit is a hit. And it was the right thing to do, because it got us to a very broad audience. And to my mind, looking back, you know, in retrospect, I think it's a very good rock song, and I think it's probably one of the better records we ever made. We were still very poor. Nothing had changed from that point of view, because we were still, I think we were on 20 quid a week at that point, you know, from our management company. I'm not exaggerating. And, you know, it was that point where the managers are all building their swimming pools and driving around in their Rolls Royces, and you're thinking, where did it all go? So there was a crisis coming, obviously, there was a crunch coming. And that's the kind of period where I remember Freddie saying that he needed a piano. And they said, yes, well, we rent you a piano. If we gave you the money, you'd only spend it, wouldn't you? You know, so there was definitely a management crisis coming along. But we had the external trappings of being stars, and I'm sure everybody thought we were millionaires.
fucking kiss my ass goodbye.
The management thing was a headache. We didn't go in it to make money, that's for sure. You know, we went in it because we wanted to do what we do, and we thought we had something to say. But at the same time, when you're scraping around to try and feed the beginnings of a family and you've got no income, it's not great. So yes, we came to a crisis with our managers, and we looked for a way out, which was quite difficult actually, because they had us quite neatly bound up contractually. But with the help of a very good lawyer, we found our way out. And John Reed, this is cutting a very long story short, because we saw other managers as well, including Peter Grant. Peter Grant was was wonderfully helpful to us, actually, very generous to us, and gave us his advice free of any kind of encumbrance. But we ended up going with John Reed, who was Elton's manager at the time, and there was a moment where John said, okay, I can now do this. You're going to be free of your old commitments to Trident, and you go away and make the best record you've ever made, and I will sort out the money side. So I think he put us on like 30 quid a week instead of 20 quid a week, and we were made. No, it was a little bit better than that, but you know, it was very much make or break at that time. And I think if we hadn't made A Night at the Opera and Bohemian Rhapsody hadn't been the huge hit that it was, it's questionable whether we would have been able to carry on that much longer in the huge debt that we were up to that point. When you're in debt, people don't want to hire you PAs and lights. And you know, it becomes very difficult if you're in debt for a long time, which we were.
And this is a big last shot, you know, bang. And I had great faith in Bohemian Rhapsody and the band.
So we just let it all rip, you know.
It was either going to be something that worked or really didn't work. And happily, it was the former.
Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy? Caught in a landslide. No escape from reality. Open your eyes. Look up to the skies and see. I'm just a poor boy. I need no sympathy. Because I'm easy come, easy go. Little high, little low. Anywhere the wind blows doesn't really matter. Just begun, but now I've gone and thrown it all.
little silhouette of a man.
Scaramouche, Scaramouche, will you do the fandango?
Thunderbolts and lightning, very, very frightening me.
Galileo, Galileo,
Galileo, Figaro,
Magnifico.
Oh, I'm just a poor boy, nobody loves me.
He's just a poor boy from a poor family, sparing his life from this monstrosity.
Easy come, easy go, will you let me go?
Bismillah!
No, we will not let you go.
Let him go!
Bismillah!
We will not let you go.
Let him go!
Bismillah!
We will not let you go.
Let me go!
We will not let you go.
Let me go!
We will not let you go.
Let me go.
Mamma mia,
mamma mia, let me go.
Beelzebub has a devil put aside for me, for me, for me.
I'm Bob Harris, and this is 1975, the year of Queen. So by the middle of 1975, all the elements were dropping into place for Queen. They had new management, they had some money in their pockets, a headlining UK tour, and the best music of their careers wrapped up and ready to go. There was just one thing missing.
The big difference on that tour from the previous one was that we had this... the beginnings of some TV reinforcement. Now, I remember going out with Mott the Hoople on their tour, which is our first British tour, and they would stop every now and again to go in and do a Top of the Pops, and that would be an enormous kind of... have an enormous effect on the audience. They would come in knowing it, you know, and there was a real feeling of, this is now, this is happening.
It did sort of take us onto another level, which we were very aware of, really, and as we went around the world, we sort of saw... and we saw the power of the video as well, which came out of the song Bohemian Rhapsody, which we made a video for simply because we were on tour and we weren't able to go on Top of the Pops.
Because TV makes all the difference. It's TV which makes you stopped in the street. It makes people feel like they know you.
Top of the Pops was, you know, the big springboard, I suppose, in terms of success. But and sadly, it had this awful lip sync tradition, you know, and which we were always uncomfortable with, and some people were actually brilliant at it, but we weren't, you know, we dealt with it, but we were always very uncomfortable, weren't we?
Yeah, it was odd, very unreal kind of situation.
You know, something's wrong when, as a drummer, when they're giving you plastic cymbals that don't make any noise when you hit them. it's sort of, it's like giving sort of Paganini a violin with no strings on it, you know. Here you go, mate, do your best, you know.
Well, there was nothing like that, of course, on the old Great Whistle Test, where bands rose or fell entirely on their musical ability. And so Queen were very happy to accept our invitation to broadcast live from the Hammersmith Odeon on Christmas Eve 1975.
I think when you're on a tour, you get a certain momentum. And I remember being quite worried because we had to break. I can't remember how long it was for. It was either a week or 10 days or something like that. I remember thinking, and then we've got to go back and just do this one. And not only that, this one is going to be live on TV and radio. And are we going to lost? Will we have lost our momentum and our, you know, all that sort of stuff that you developed on a tour? That sort of magic moment. It's so true. You know, it was. And plus the fact having the flu, it made it a very hard, tough night for me. So,
you've been at home, haven't you, as well? You spent time at home. Yeah. At the end, you sort of got out of the tour feeling. So it was hard to get ourselves back into that place. So, you were not well at all, were you?
No. You have to drag yourself up from the ground again. So I do remember being quite sort of worried about it.
So the scene is set. I'm dressed up in white top hat and tails, ready to introduce the band to a national audience in front of a local audience well into the Christmas spirit. Everything was ready to go.
We normally did a big dramatic entrance and everything was dark and there was lots of noise and smoke and dry ice and explosions and stuff. And so it gave you great confidence coming on the stage. On this occasion, they had the audience lit for TV. So we went on stage and kind of looked around and there were all the people's faces. It was quite strange and eerie and nerve-wracking. It was new to me because we hadn't done telly before, really. And not only that, they weren't ready for us. They were saying, no, another 2 minutes, just hold it, you know, and then 10, 9, 8, whatever. So you're doing all this in front of your audience. It was really strange because we weren't communicating. It was like there was a wall, sort of a transparent wall there, and then suddenly it was going to come down. But it did. As soon as we were on, and it suddenly everything changed, and the audience kind of got up and did a lot of waving and a lot of noise, which was great, and we were into it. But I remember that first moment as being quite unreal, really. Very strange.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Queen.
See you.
As you've just heard, the concert went down a storm and went a long way to establishing Queen as one of the greatest British rock bands ever. Mightily relieved, they were able to approach the encores in rather more relaxed fashion.
You've done your show, you've done what you came there to do, and you've given people their money's worth. And it's like you have license to just have fun. And I think that's a special moment. We always thought it was a great time. So we don't do our own songs anymore. We do other people's songs where you can feel really free. Everybody knows them. And also, we'd always done them from the very beginning. If we wanted to have fun, we would be playing, you know, Jailhouse Rock or Stupid Cupid, or which was very, very much a Freddie thing, you know, and we loved it. It was something really fun. You had to smile. You had to really get into it. So, in a way, all the barriers are down. The audience and us are almost indistinguishable. We're just having a good time, and we love that rock and roll stuff. Suited Freddie very well, I've got to say. It's Freddie's heroes were like Elvis and Cliff, you know, when he was a boy in India, he was singing these rock and roll songs, and he loved it. It was a second nature to him.
Ooh, it's a trying to share. Stupid Cupid, stop playing that game. Hey, hey, set me free. Stupid Cupid, stop playing.
So the show's done, it's gone really well, and everybody goes home happy. Well, everybody apart from Roger Taylor.
And I had a brand new thing called a video recorder at home, and I got home still with my raging flu, and very keen to see what we'd got, and of course I'd done something wrong. And
thank you very much. Good night, everybody.
So 40 years on, how do Brian and Roger look back on Queen's legacy and on that year that made them what they are today?
I love it. You know, I love what's happened to us. I love the privileges we've had and the incredible places we've been. But there's always a part of me which is a little bit somewhere else. You know, I have a little sort of element of detachment, I suppose. I don't know whether that's good or bad. It's just another element in the whole mix that was Queen. And is, I suppose it is, kind of still is Queen, because we'll die being Queen. I realise that now. You know, when Freddie went, there was definitely a moment for me, I don't know about the others, but where I just wanted to junk it all. I didn't want to be called guitarist of Queen anymore. To me, that was over, and I didn't want to think about it. I went out on tour and didn't want to mention Queen, didn't want to play Queen songs. And it was kind of necessary at the time. I had to go through that. It was a cleansing and an experience which enabled me to move on. But it was ultimately completely wrong, because people will always see us in that way, and you can adapt it and modify it, but basically I will always be that guy who was in Queen and did that stuff. And I'm not really bothered about that anymore. I don't feel like I have to apologise for it anymore. It's part of me, and it's, my God, we worked all those years to build up that wonderful thing that was Queen, so I'm not going to kind of decry it anymore. You know, I feel comfortable with being whatever Queen is in 2000, and I couldn't define it, but it's still here.
And if 1975 hadn't proved to be so crucial to the band, how would things have turned out?
Who knows? You know, I might have been a plumber. I would have survived, though.
This is BBC Radio 2, online, on digital radio, and on 88 to 91 FM.